change makes a big difference is the slogan. So even a small change in your behavior, small change in your routine, small change in your dressing will make a huge change in the rest of the place. I am BA Mechanical, BA in Linguistics, Masters in Management Studies, MA in Economics, MA in Political Sciences, 18 years of industry experience. I do corporate training, life coaching, counseling, outbound training. I am a human resource developer. I apply ancient wisdom to modern problems. I have given lectures on understanding and dealing with stress, food habits of ancient rishis, vastu for health and happiness, Indian mythology and management. This is corporate training. This is special training for business owners. This is goal-oriented training. This is large seminars. I am invited as researcher on various topics related to ancient wisdom on variety of TV channels, especially during the elections.
Very much needed.
Yes. Yes, true. This is corporate sector clients, then HR sector clients, social sector, education sector. I also give speeches at Rotary, Lions and Freemasons. In fact, I am one of the very few speakers who have addressed the combined meetings of Lions, Rotary and Freemasons. These are three different organizations. They don't usually have meetings together, but I have been there. This is where it was a combined meeting of Lions, Rotary and Freemasons. I have written 5 books so far. All the questions you have about occult sciences answered. That was one. Beware your hand speaks. Second, ancient wisdom basics, face reading and mystic vibrations. Out of these, mystic vibrations is available in this library. Also, I think face reading also is available in this library. Yeah, yes. Okay, and Indian ethos in corporate sector and ancient wisdom for modern problems is my how we can utilize ancient wisdom for modern problems is the research that I go into. Thank you. And before we start, we'll thank all of you, help library and myself, because three of us are making this possible. So let's go. Neurodynamic programming or neurodynamic management. What it basically means is your mind, body and brain. Mind, body and brain, these are three entities which are simultaneous and not one after the other. Okay. Mind, body and brain. Now I am writing it in linear fashion, but actually it is something like this. These work simultaneously. There is no hierarchy. There is no boss. Or simultaneously at any point of time, sometimes mind is the boss, sometimes body is the boss, sometimes brain is the boss. Sometimes all of them are the bosses. Yeah, so this is simultaneous system and it is not linear system. Okay. We'll start with the example of how it works. Many times when you are sitting for a long time, you might have experienced that a certain part of your body becomes numb. Have you experienced it?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you do when it goes numb? Yeah, we try to move that part.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, yes, if that hand is numb. Right. I'll tell you another key. Next time any part of your body gets numb, what you should do is move your head. Yes. And that numbness, yes. How it is related, that we'll see. What actually happens is in the body, whole time this brain is looking at the whole body. brain is continuously sending nerve signals to the rest of the body and back. So these nerve signals keep going from the brain to the body, and from here they keep on going backwards. So that is how the brain knows that the whole body is present. Even if you are sleeping, somebody scratches your leg, you will take the leg. Yes. Because, yes, the body is realizing that the body is whole. Okay. So all the time, these brain signals or signals from the backbone keep on going to the whole of the body, checking up whether whole body is present. Just like a teacher keeps taking attendance every now and then to see every student is in the class and attentive, that is the way this brain keeps on doing it. Now what happens is, when you are sitting in a wrong position or in a position where certain nerve gets pressed, that time, for example, this is your hand and here the nerve gets pressed, then what happens is the signal going from the brain does not reach the hand. I am showing a very crude picture of hand, but just be with me. Yeah. So this hand has become numb, but from the brain's point of view, the hand has been cut off. The hand does not exist. Because the hand does not exist, that's why it becomes numb. Nerve signals are coming up to this point and nerve signals are not going forward.
Nerves. Flow of blood is not there.
No, flow of blood is there. If the flow of blood is not there, your hand will become blue. Sensation. Blood is flowing.
Sensation is not there.
Because, this nerve, some of these nerves which are going to this point are getting pressed. Because they are pressed. Yes. It is as if the road going from the brain to that point is blocked somewhere. Nakabandi ho gaya. Whereas the blood circulation is there because the road going from the heart to that part is still there. The road from the heart to that part is there, but the road from the brain to that part is blocked. So the nerve current comes up to this, it goes back. Nerve current comes up to this, it goes back. And the brain assumes that the hand or leg or that part of the body is no more there. Okay?
Cramps
I will come later on. Yeah. Okay. Now what happens is, after some time you become aware that a part of your body is numb. Then you shake this hand that is numb. The moment you shake this hand, the nerve is free and the nerve current goes to the brain. Suddenly the brain realizes the signal is coming from this point. Then the brain starts sending signal again to that point, and then slowly that numbness goes away. Okay, now when the numbness completely goes away, when the brain starts feeling or brain starts visualizing the body as a whole again.
But most of the time that numbs never goes.
Huh? It
remains for last 1 year, 1.5 year, 2 years.
That should not happen. Then there is some problem with the nerves.
But
that we'll see later on. Yeah. At the moment we are looking at the numbness which goes away. Yeah. Now, when I said another way of doing this is shaking the head. Because what happens is, when you are shaking the head, first there is a first visualization that the body is without a certain part. When you are shaking the head, the earlier visualization, earlier image is going away, and the new image of the body, which was from the earlier on, it is something like a computer. In case of computer, when computer goes down, when it starts again, it will go to the earliest possible combination.
Restart.
So the brain restarts again when you shake it. Or even you shake it like this. Yeah, it restarts, and the restart figure is a complete body. When the restart figure is complete body, instantaneously you will see the numbness will go away. This is where, in the first place, what you have done is, when you have shaken your hand, you have used your body to remove the numbness. In the second part, you have used your brain to remove your numbness. And why did the numbness come in the first place? Because you are not minding, or you are not aware that you are sitting in an unnatural position. Okay? So it started from mind.
So mind and brain, they both are very different.
They are different. They are different. Because we don't know where the mind is located. What we say is every cell has got a mind. Every cell. Whereas brain and body are physical entities. Body we can touch, brain we can see through machine. Mind we cannot see.
But the entire body, mind of the body.
Yeah.
Is what we can define. How we can define.
We don't know. If even doctors are not defining.
Are having a mind.
Yes.
Then the collectively mind, when it acts.
Yeah.
When it takes a decision.
Yeah.
So how we can define that?
Mind, we don't know whether mind is the one which is taking the decision. Meaning of the decisions are taken by the brain. But there is mind, and at cellular level, the mind takes the decision. Like for example, when you are feeling full, it is not a decision taken by a cell, it is a decision taken by the brain. And the some cells in the stomach are sending signal to the brain that the stomach is full. And brain says, okay, now the stomach is full, stop eating. So it is not necessary that a mind should be the one to take the decision. As we said, these three things together take the decision, or any one of them can individually take the decision. That is what that neurodynamic programming is all about, or neurodynamic management is all about. Okay. Okay. So what we are saying here is brain, body and mind are intimately, integratively, simultaneously connected. Okay. Any intervention, improvement anywhere creates corresponding change in all three. The most important sentence of today's talk. Any intervention or improvement anywhere, be it brain, be it body or be it mind, it will create corresponding change in all three. Because they are simultaneously, integratively and intimately connected. Expressions, gestures, words are directly connected to brain mechanism and state of mind. Okay? Expressions and gestures and words are all body. They are directly connected to brain mechanism and state of mind. Yeah? This is something that we have demonstrated last time. We can even demonstrate just now. I mean, if you just smile just now, you will feel better. Smiling is a physical thing, but the brain will feel better, mind will feel better. So it is an expression that will make your brain mechanism feel better, that will make your state of mind better. Idiom can be used to improve our lives in all areas. Improving health, changing habits, improving concentration, dealing with stress, etc., etc. And we are limited virtually or literally only by our imagination. Our imagination is what stops us from doing anything. So change the imagination, everything else will change. We can improve in terms of mind, body and brain. We can utilize mind, body and brain, all of three for improvement. And any little change anywhere will reflect everywhere else. Okay? Okay. This was what we had seen last time. Or 2-3 sessions before, where we just ask people to think that one of their hands is heavy and one of their hands is light. This was the starting photo where everybody's hand is level. This gentleman's hand is already going up. And after 3 or 4 minutes, what we see one hand has gone down so much, one hand has come up. Interestingly, these two ladies who were sitting behind, both of them were doctors. And they said that their hands remained at the same level. If some of us remember here, their hands remained at the same level. But they said later on that their hands are paining.
Because they were concentrating completely.
Their body was refusing to move the hands as per the brain.
Yeah, I mean they were concentrating. Yeah, I have to do this.
Yes, exactly. And as
because
a result of which...
They were giving the signals, their own signals.
Yes. Or they were stopping the signals.
Yeah.
Yes.
The natural signals they were stopping.
Right. It is as if the car is in neutral and you are revving it. the car is roaring.
For second hand to go down.
Pardon? We have said one hand is light. In one hand, what we said, ask them to imagine is in one hand you are holding some weight, and on the other, in the other hand you are having a balloon, helium balloon fitted to it. So one hand is becoming lighter, one hand is becoming heavier. So now this is the instruction to the brain, and that instruction is directly getting translated to something that is physical. So in other words, it means that if you tell yourself that you are happy, your body will accept that you are happy. If you tell your body that you are unhappy, your body will accept that too. Okay? So in many cases, many of the diseases or many of the smaller problems that we face, or many of the irritants or habits that we face, are because we are telling our body to do that. Subconsciously, unconsciously, superconsciously, whatever way. But we are the ones who are telling it. And how we can stop doing it is by using the other two. Okay. So, I'll give another example. This example we have given before also. Say, consider that you have gone to a hotel and you have eaten a soup. That soup is very nice for taste, but there is something stale in that soup. Something that was not well prepared. Yeah, some ingredient. As a result of which, when you go home, you start vomiting after two or three hours. Yeah. Now what is this? This is something that was wrong in the soup, and that has caused some problem to the body. So the starting was physical, end was physical. The okay, I'll take this off. Case one is the reason is physical, and result is physical. Okay. Now consider this case, that you go to the same hotel and have the same soup. This time nothing is wrong in the soup. You enjoy the soup till the last spoon, and in the last spoon you get a spider. So when you see that, immediately you feel really disgusted and you vomit. Now see, now there is nothing wrong in the soup. So there is no physical reason. Yes, it is mental. Or the reason is mind, result is still physical. Okay. In fact, the reason is not even mind. I'll tell you why. It is brain. Because our brain is hardwired to be disgusted at certain things. When we see a snake, when we see a spider, when we see a scorpion, when we see something that is dangerous, it is our brain response. Even a child will not go near to these things. And that is what has made us survive. So this is called as hardwired brain. Okay. So in this case, the reason is brain, the result is physical. Okay. Now consider.
Imagination already is existing.
It is something.
What brain thoughts?
Yeah.
It is imagination or.
No, it is seen. When you see a spider, your brain gives you, this is called as an evolutionary response. It has been seen that in case of a monkey, even if a rope is thrown, it will run to the end of the room. Yeah, because its brain tells it that you should be, something that is moving in this way is dangerous. And this is called as evolutionary response for the survival of the human being. You have to survive many situations, and those situations you will survive when certain things is hardwired. Without telling you. And for example, the certain smells, we all of us feel disgusted at certain smells. Why do we feel that? Because our brain tells us so. That this smell is dangerous. We are all attracted towards sweet smell. So something that is smelling sweet, our brain tells us that it is naturally good. Yeah? Okay. Now, we go to the same restaurant again. I don't know why we keep on going to the same restaurant again and again, and we have the same soup. Soup is very nice. Nothing is wrong. There is no spider. We have that soup. We come home. After a couple of days, we are talking with one of our friends and we talk about this soup. We are praising it to the sky. And then that friend says, I know that restaurant. The soup that you are talking about is a beef soup. And you are a total vegetarian person. What do you think happens? You feel very disgusted and you vomit. Interestingly, this is not even brain reaction. This is the mind reaction. Because as far as the brain is concerned or the body is concerned, there is nothing wrong with veg or non-veg or any type of non-veg for that matter. But you are culturally, we are groomed to feel disgust or not to eat certain kind of foods, and it is a mental reaction. The reason is mind, the reaction is physical. In all three cases, the result has been, our action has been physical, but the starting point has been different. Okay? So we have to work on the starting point. For example, here anybody, any national, anybody would feel, would be having this problem. Here also anybody will have that problem, but this is something cultural. Not everybody in the world will be having the same reaction. This is a learned response. And what is called as learned response is coming from the mind. Okay? So in this case, any one of the cycle or any one of the chain that we break, then the cycle will not happen. Cycle will not occur. That is what NDM is about. Neurodynamic management. Okay? Now, interesting thing is, the body is easiest to access but most difficult to change. We can touch our body, we can feel our body, we can move our body. Brain is difficult to access but easier to change. And the third is most difficult to access but the easiest to change. This is a categorization. Mind you cannot access, brain is difficult to access, body is the easiest to access. But in case of difficulty of changing, body is the most difficult to change. Mind is easiest to change, but it keeps changing. So you control the mind, you control all three. Another part is, the path to each goes through the other two. So you want to control the mind, you can control it through body, or you can control it through brain. You want to control the body, you have to control it through mind, or you have to control it through brain. You are getting it? This is the way it will work. So at any point, you got minimum two agencies which you can use to control the third. Okay. Now, so far so good. What is the utility of neurodynamic programming or neurodynamic management? To find easier ways to connect the body, mind and brain. To improve the understanding, retention, empathy and health. To create and maintain success habits. Or to understand and utilize our potentials to the maximum. How do it? Now we come to this part of it. Easier ways of connecting mind. For example, what happens is, this is our brain. I will put it this way. Seen from the top, it is this way. And seen from the side, it is this way. So there is a point at the center of the brain which is called the pleasure center. And anything that we do in our life is for that pleasure. So we do something because we feel pleasure. All bad habits are there because in those bad habits, yes, all bad habits are there, or all habits are there because at the end of that habit we feel pleasure. We drink tea in the morning, or we drink tea because at the end of the tea we feel pleasure. People who smoke They smoke because at the end of smoke they feel pleasure. Okay, people eat pan because when they chew pan they feel pleasure. Okay, and now the interesting part is that pleasure is like the road in the brain. Okay, now and this bad habit or habit is the shortest path to that pleasure. So using NDM, any habit you want to break, what we want to do, we'll see this allegory. For example, this is road from A to B. This is a wide road, or this is a shortcut which is next to your home. Yeah, like from your home there is a small gully which is connected to the highway. You are always using that because it is the nearest route. How do you stop from using it? Only when you use a diversion and block it. You make another route to the pleasure and you block the original route. Only then this can happen. So in case of a habit, if you want to break a habit, you have to build a new habit. Yes, and block the old route. When you block the old route for a long enough time, between 27 days to 3 months, the old route will start shrinking. It will not go away because most of the routes in the brain are permanent, but it will start shrinking and the new route will start forming. When the new route has become wide and deep, we'll be using the new route and not using the old route. That is where the habit will start dying. It will not go away, but it will be there, but it will not be used. Okay.
Yeah. That nicotine patch.
Yes, exactly. You are getting the same pleasure in some other way. You have to get that pleasure, be it from nicotine or be it from something else. So, for example, you are going from a smoking cigarette, to going to a smokeless cigarette, then going to nicotine patch, and then maybe even leaving that away. Yeah, and then chewing gum, maybe. Yes. So that is the way. What you are doing here is the habit is in the brain. You are using your body or mind, both, to remove that habit. And the same thing we can utilize for doing almost virtually anything. Because whatever you feel you do, you can do, or whatever you feel you cannot do, both ways you are right. You only need to find a way to do it. And if the problem is in the mind, the way to do is in the body or the brain. If the problem is in the brain, the way to do it is through mind and the body. And if the problem is in the body, then the way to do it is in the mind and the brain. What is the example of a problem in the body? The runner who did not have legs. What he did was, using his brain and mind, first thing he got some artificial legs, and then the interesting part was he was running better than the regular people, okay, in the Olympics. And the people, no, it is real, it is real, it is fact, it is fact. See, the fun part was, in case of body, you will see that when you are running, your weakest muscle is this. This is your foot and this is your weakest muscle. So when you are running or when you are walking a lot, you will see that you are talking about the cramp and so on, right? Somebody was talking about cramp. Where you will get cramp? You generally will not get a cramp in the thigh. You will get a cramp in the calf. Yeah. Now this is the point where the calf muscle is. And you will get a cramp always in the calf. Because why the cramp occurs is when you are tired, the muscle, the waste products that are built up in the muscle, they should be carried away by the blood. they are not carried away fast enough, when they are not carried away fast enough, they get stored here, and when that storage becomes bigger than a certain point, the body says enough. That muscle cannot take anything more, muscle contracts and refuses to work. So it is basically the body which is telling the brain that I got enough, I cannot work anymore, enough of this. And that is the way of the body telling the brain and the mind that I have been overworked. That is when the cramp is developing. Okay, yeah.
No, but this what you are saying is that whenever the person is running and all.
Yeah.
But besides that, even in the sleep also.
Yes.
Or early in the morning also.
Yes.
Cramp in the calf.
Yes.
So
it is the same thing. Body is telling.
But we're relaxing at that time.
Yes, at that time, what you had done before, you have not taken in before sleeping.
Result is that.
Earlier day, check whether you have had enough drink.
Enough?
Drink, water. Okay. Have you taken enough water? Okay. Mostly, when you are having a cramp in the morning, what it is saying is you are not drunk enough water. So, I have not had enough agency to remove the waste material from the muscles to wherever it should have gone. So in the night, what you are doing in the night, the whole body is working to remove the waste material from the whole of the body and throw it out of the body. But what is the agency for that? Agency for that is water, and agency for that is breath and blood. Yeah, but the main agency is water. So if you are not drunk enough water the earlier day, then this is what will happen in the morning. In fact, this is exactly what will happen when you have constipation. Not enough water or not enough food. Food in terms of the food, wastage food. Yeah. If that is so, the body is telling you.
But why it happens only in the clap? What is the reason for?
Because it is the weakest muscle.
Weakest muscle?
Yeah. Wherever is the weakest, it will happen first. It's like the fuse. Why does the fuse only go?
What waste material get jam over there? Because of blood circulation is not proper in that particular region?
Not because of blood circulation. Blood is circulating, but it does not have enough water to take away. Yes. For example, if you do not drink enough water, we have got another lecture which is dealing with water, which we have talked about. Yeah. So if you do not have enough water in the body, then the body, what the body is going to tell you, I don't have enough water. But still, if you don't listen to it, it is going to create some problem somewhere, wherever the water shortage is there. Like for example, in our home, if there is water shortage, after some time you will see that the bathroom or the toilet is stinking. You will see that the floor is not clean, and so on and so forth. So if the water shortage is chronic, then you will always see that always the toilet is stinking. You are getting it? So on and so forth. So now, here in this case, coming back to that person, this is the weakest muscle when you are running. Now, this fellow did not have this muscle at all, this part. So he attached a metal part to the body. So what is happening? He is taking away the weakest muscles, or the muscles that will get cramped, and that's why he is able to run faster. Yes. And that is why other runners were complaining that this fellow is running faster than us because of this reason. Actual case. So many people know about it. Pistorius is the name of the runner. Yeah.
This pain in the calf.
Yeah.
Can it be controlled by head moving head?
No. Because it is something physical. It is actually a mechanism. It is telling you there is something wrong. So temporarily you can reduce it or normalize it by pressing. But you got to drink water. You got to do something. You got to massage it and so on. Because this pain is only an indication. Pain is only a signal. By just changing the signal, you cannot control traffic. The traffic is the problem here. And the signal is a temporary solution. Okay.
And what is happening when the two fingers are overlapping each other and it is for the long time in the same situation.
It is that just
also a cramp.
No, that is not a cramp. That is a nerve. You are pressing a nerve. So nerve signal is not going to the brain. As soon as you remove, as soon as you move the fingers, the nerve current starts.
No, we are not moving the body, it automatically gets.
Yeah.
When we go in the rainy water.
Yeah.
Or when we work in the water.
Yeah.
Rain,
yeah.
Most of the time.
Yeah.
Because of the coldness, the
yeah.
fingers get overlap each other.
Okay.
And it remains for a longer time.
Yeah.
It's become harder.
Yeah.
It's not a numb.
Yes, okay.
It's like a
clap. Yes, your question itself, your question has got itself, it has got the answer. See, one finger is feeling cold, the other finger also is feeling cold. What the two finger?
Frozen fingers.
No, not frozen fingers. What do you do when you feel cold? You go to the next, you go to your neighbor. When you are feeling cold, your hand will not be like this. Your hand will be like this, clamped. When you feel cold, what you do? Yes, that's exactly what is happening. So when fingers are overlapping, what the fingers are doing, the fingers are having a mind of their own. So they are going to then their nearest neighbor to get some heat. As soon as you get heat, it will open up.
But it goes in hardening state. Muscles are becoming very tight.
No, that is something, then it has got something to do with some chronic disease or some chronic problem and not something to do with
so
these.
I don't know.
Because that chronic part is not a part of that NDM. This is chronic is something that has been happening over a period of time, over a period of long time. Yeah. And then we have not done any remedy to that. Then that remedy and the problem both have to be seen in that way. Okay. So here what we are talking about is in a day-to-day work. In day-to-day work, it will require 27 days remedy. But in case what you are talking about is something that is chronic, that has to be treated something differently. Yeah?
What about the frozen shoulder?
Frozen shoulder is also, frozen shoulder is actually mental reaction. In a way, it is a mental reaction of that muscle, particular muscle which has got inflamed and because of which the shoulder's movement is restricted. And that is why slowly the frozen shoulder will go away on its own. It takes about 2 years time, whereby the muscle itself finds a way out. Muscle itself finds a way out of that inflammation, and at the end of that frozen shoulder, there is a limited mobility, or mobility is restricted. By restricting the mobility, you have found a way. The body finds a way out of the problem. Okay. At the beginning of the frozen shoulder, we don't know why the frozen shoulder happens. But at the same time,
continuous sleep in the same position.
Maybe.
For a longer time.
Maybe one of the reasons. But may not be one of the reasons. Actually, the.
It happens more with diabetic people.
Yeah, that's there. Other complications are going to be there. Any inflammation of any muscle is going to be more when you got some other.
No, but people, those who are moving all the time, they never get frozen
shoulder. No, not
people,
true.
Those who are bedridden.
No, not true. Not true. Even the people who are having full motion. Yes. Yes.
You said 2 years, take 2 years. But how about physiotherapy? Can
if you take physiotherapy, the time duration might reduce to maybe 1 year, maybe 8 months. But generally, a frozen shoulder will go away on its own. Even if you don't take any medicine, even if you don't take any physiotherapy, because it is an inflammation of the muscle and the muscle itself will react, the body itself will react. It is something called as psychosomatic, psycho, soma, that is a body, psychosomatic disease.
Yeah. What about application of external pain relieving balms or things like that?
Yeah, it will give you temporary release. Yes. Okay, so now what is the NDM cycle? First is listen to the body. Listen. Listen to body, mind, brain, whatever. Yeah? And listening to the body is the easiest. First is listen, then understand what is happening, just the way we did today. Digest the details. Then do the corrective action. Take the feedback and again listen. So this is a cycle. We have to listen, understand, digest, do something and take the feedback and then again go to listening. So the key area in NDM is listening. Listen, listen and listen. Short form is LUDDF. Okay. So for example, one of the examples that we take is common office worker health problems are wrist pain, lower back pain, spondylitis, joint pain, constipation, eye strain, food poisoning, lung problems, blood pressure, headache.
Everything.
Yes, almost. And why this happen is because the
wrong posture.
Yes.
Posture.
This position is called as a worrier stance. Worrier, the person who worries. Just think of it, how you sit when you are worried. When you are worried, you will sit like this. And it is not because of posture, but because of the mind. Because of the mind, the body is taking that posture. And in that posture, you are sitting whole day like this. And because of the worry in the mind and the body and the brain and taking this position, all these problems will come up. So, all these problems can be cured by doing what? Getting a chair that is not comfortable.
Okay.
Getting
that comfort
cured.
Has to be broken.
Yes. Getting a chair that is not comfortable. And what we keep doing in the office? Yes, more and more and more comfortable chair, more and more and more comfortable atmosphere, AC and so on, more and more comfortable workstation, as a result of which we sit for more and more time and we invite all these troubles. Yes, it's a big paradox.
No, what is like the job that one is doing?
Yes. Yeah. No, even if person likes the job that he is doing, still what is happening is he is taking a posture which is a worrier posture.
Right person at wrong chair.
Yes. Yes. And he's.
If you take the right chair, then it won't be.
That's exactly the paradox, sir. What I am saying is, what is the meaning of a right chair? The meaning of a right chair is the chair that allows you to sit for a long time. But then it is a wrong chair. Because you sit for a long time and you do the same work, you are going to get that lower back pain and then joint pains and constipation and eye strain and so on and so forth. So the remedy is not getting a comfortable chair, remedy is getting an uncomfortable chair. Or maybe even a stool. Simple stool, because on a simple stool you will work for 15-20 minutes, then you will get tired and then you will walk around. Yes. Yes. So you see how the NDM turns the problem on its head. For this problem, generally the problem solution is given is get a comfortable chair, get an ergonomic chair, get a good atmosphere, get good AC, get good position, keep the distance, 12 inches, etc., etc. None of these situations, none of these solutions will work. And the solution is simple. NDM solution is get an uncomfortable chair. Okay? So that you cannot sit there for more than 15-20 minutes. At the end of 15-20 minutes, you got to move. And when you move, most of these problems will go away. Where are you going to move to? You are either going to go and drink some water or go to the toilet. Or go somewhere else and take half a cup of coffee or something else. You are going to do something. And when you do that something, this problem will go away. So I am coming to the end of this lecture now. And what I have just demonstrated is the power of NDM. And turning the whole problem on its head. The problem that does not come through common sense. The problem that does not come through modern science, but the problem that comes through ancient wisdom. And that ancient wisdom is called as neurodynamic management. Direct application of neurodynamic management. Okay. So other techniques, what are the other techniques? Are H meditation, which we have demonstrated here, progressive muscle relaxation, achievement rehearsal exercise, non-dominant skill practice, shadow boxing, integrative corroborative method, amygdala simulation. These are the various techniques of NDM. Yeah, but the basic theory and the demonstration we have done just now. Okay, what is the summary? Brain, body and mind are intimately, integratively, simultaneously connected. Any intervention, improvement anywhere creates corresponding change in all three. Expressions, gestures, words are directly connected to brain mechanism and state of mind. NDM can be used to improve our lives in all areas. Just now what we have seen in that chair exercise. Improving health, changing habits, improving concentration, dealing with stress, etc., etc., etc. We are limited virtually and in literally only by our imagination. So NDM techniques provide instant and long lasting results. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.